Hello, everybody. Welcome to Old Tales of Nevada, Past and Present. Glad to have you with us this week. We're going to have a great show. We're going back in time, yet somewhere in time. So we'll tell you all about it when we come back after these messages.
Hi there. I'm Hugh Roy Marshall of the Marshall Mint in Virginia City, Nevada. I'm proud to announce that our 7-ingot set honoring the V&T Railroad is now finished.
That's right, Hugh Roy. These beautiful 999 silver ingots celebrate the engines from the world-famous V&T Railroad and honor Nevada's sesquicentennial. These limited edition treasures can be purchased only at the Marshall Mint in Virginia City, Nevada.
Or visit us at marshallmint.com to get yours today.
Shoeman's Custom Cycle. We're the Biker's Bike Shop. From the new Santa pipes to custom renovations, building ultimate machines is our reputation. Feel the performance, experience the power. From chrome to leather, the selection doesn't quit. If it wasn't done to Shoeman's, it ain't. Shoeman's Custom Cycle. We're the Biker's Bike Shop.
When it comes to cleaning your carpet and tile, make the right choice and call A-Choice. They use a two-step deep extraction steam cleaning system that removes dirt and those nasty mites and bacteria from your carpet and tile. A-Choice offers baby-safe cleaning products and specializes in pet odor removal. So make the fresher, cleaner, healthier choice. Call A-Choice Carpet and Tile Cleaning, locally owned and operated at 745-1863.
The beautiful fall colors are being duplicated in the fall collection of fashions at Boutique Elegante. Sweaters are either in the crayon colors for fall or soft muted shades in bark and beige. For our cold winter days, jackets and vests are the perfect answer. Full fur and full leather are the strong fabrics for this season. Team them with maxi skirts for a beautiful seasonal look. All of this and so much more at Boutique Elegante.
Welcome, everybody, to Old Tales of Nevada, Past and Present. I'm John O'Brien, the host of the show, and we're here at a special place today. We're here at a place called Somewhere in Time. You've probably gone by it many, many times. It's on Virginia Street in Arroyo at the Statewide Lighting Center, and we're right in the middle of the center, easy parking out there. But the reason we're here is to explore history, because there's a lot of items in this store that are very unique, and people really don't get to see it very often, although the store's been here for how long?
Been about 10 years now.
About 10 years. With me today is Dan Clements. He's an antiquer, a collector of all kinds of items, and has space here in the store, and really kind of takes care of the store in a lot of different ways, along with some of the other vendors.
Well, we all help.
We all help, yeah. So anyway, we're looking forward to exploring the store and seeing some of these historical items that perhaps people haven't seen and haven't been in the store to take a look at. So we look forward to that. But I'd like to ask you, Dan, now you've been in Reno forever, or are you a native?
Yes, I am. My dad started a farm out in Fernley in 1955, and that's when I was born.
1955.
So I've lived here my whole life.
So what kind of a farm was it? Did you grow tomatoes?
No, it's got alfalfa and pet cows. Is really
what it is. Pet cows, yeah, right. So was it a thriving kind of a farm, or was it a hobby?
It was probably half and half. He had to work full-time as well, so... Yeah. Always would see him come home at night and then go out and work in the fields when I was young. And then as we got older, we started helping too.
Yeah.
But it was his passion, and he did it until he died.
No kidding. So you're out there on the farm. Where did you get this interest about collecting antiques and memorabilia and things like that?
I've always liked history. And I think it really came to fruition as far as collecting was when I was in my 20s, and I went into an antique store somewhat like this, and being as a science bent, I saw a case with glass that was all glowing.
Oh.
And I found out later that it was green depression glass and Vaseline glass, and has uranium in it. And that got my interest. I started looking for it.
Wow.
And it just kind of blossomed from that.
No kidding. Yeah. So how many years you've been doing that now?
Since the 80s.
Yeah. And when did you start making money doing it?
last couple of years.
Last
when it really got serious full time.
Serious, yeah. Because I would imagine when you're starting out collecting antiques and memorabilia, it's a trial and error kind of thing. I mean, you can lose a lot of money in the training period, right?
Well, you pay your dues.
You pay your dues, yeah.
A lot of education. You read everything you can find.
Yeah. Now, when you go out and look for items, do you have something specific in mind, or are you just open to whatever you see?
I'm pretty much open to whatever I see. I've been doing it long enough now that I've got an idea of what will sell.
Oh, I see.
And I'm just looking for mostly unique things, things that you don't see every day.
Right, right. Now, where do you go to get it? Do you go to the auctions here locally only? Do you have to go travel a lot to find stuff? Do you go down to people's basements? I mean, how do you garner all of this, you know, all these items?
Yes, all of the above.
All the above.
Yeah, there's local auctions weekly, and I usually haunt them watching for things. We have people bring things into the store here for me to look at and evaluate. Mm-hmm. We get calls from people that want us to come to their home and look at things.
No kidding. So. Yeah, because we've had people on the show, to be honest with you, that have gone down into their basement or into a shed, and they find all of these items or these boxes full of stuff, but they don't know what it's worth, and so they have to get somebody there to take care of it. Sometimes they take it up to the Historical Society, but I imagine sometimes they bring it here as well.
We get a lot of that. People that have something that they've inherited and they just don't know what it is.
Yeah.
So they bring it in for me to look at and give them an idea of what they've got.
And you give them a fair price. Are you an official appraiser?
Yes,
I am. You are. Now, in a certain category or all categories?
It's general. I can't do fine jewelry because I'm not a gemologist.
Okay. You know,
there's limits, and I limit myself to the things that I'm aware of. Otherwise, I can refer them to other people. But
now, is that a license you have to get to be in a appraiser?
It's not a license, but there is classes that you take.
I see.
There's a certification process.
Okay. So what seems to be the most popular items that people want to have that you sell most of here at the store? Is there a particular category of antique or memorabilia?
It's pretty broad, but personally, I think I see Western things as being a hot item.
Yeah, yeah. Do you get a lot of people from out of town coming in to get it, or is it a lot of local folks trying to find stuff?
It's both. We have regular people that come in. Every time they come to Reno, they say, "We come over. We got to come and see your shop."
Wow. Well, I'm really, really interested in going and looking around and seeing some of these historical items that have a connection to the Comstock or down here in Reno, perhaps some of the things were used in the mines or some of the things that they furnished their homes with or drank out of or
you
whatever.
Betcha. We can do that.
All right. Well, let's start the journey here.
All righty.
All right. We're going to start over here, Dan, with a very unique collection, and that is of the brothels here in Nevada. And I guess there was an individual, right, back in the old days who was sort of an artistic kind of guy, got creative and started doing some special things for the brothels, right?
Yeah, his name was Captain Doug. And in 1968, he opened Doug's West Indies in Carson City, and he started producing these really clever little decanters. And they are whiskey decanters, and they were for the different brothels in the area.
No kidding.
And they were quite collectible. People would come, of course, and even if they didn't go to the brothel, they'd go to a little souvenir shop and I went there. Here's a souvenir. You know?
just to have some bragging rights.
Right.
But it actually held liquor, and they could buy it with the booze in it.
Right.
And do whatever with it, I suppose, you know. But you have the Kit Kat Ranch here. Kit Kat Ranch, that was down in...
It's Carson City.
Carson City. But you have a special piece there. It's a little bit more rare, I think, isn't it? The one
They're all kind of rare.
They're all rare, yeah.
You know, here's a Sagebrush Ranch. It's not as rare as maybe some of the others, but cute.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And they're all just cute.
Yeah. And what's that one that had Joe Conforti on the back? Or was it Joe Conforti property?
Okay. Yeah, this was the Triangle River Ranch.
Okay. Very good. Where was that located? Was that a...
Well, look at the little map on the back here.
It was on I-80.
I-80 at Mustang.
Yeah.
So it's one of his early ones.
Yeah, because he owned the Mustang Ranch, of course. Mm-hmm. And this is the Inez.
Now it's from Elko.
Elko, okay. Very good.
So there's just a clever little thing, and they're just a fun collectible.
Yeah. You were telling me off air that there are a lot of accomplished artists here in Northern Nevada you've been able to find over the years. Is that right?
There's a good artist community here.
Yeah.
There's the Artist Co-op Gallery down on Mill Street that represents a lot of the modern ones.
Right.
But there's some older ones. Mary Chadwell is a good artist. We've got a few of her pictures back there. Marilyn Newton.
Marilyn Newton.
And, of course, one of the characters of Reno was George Carter.
Yeah.
And he was kind of known as the mad painter of Reno.
The mad painter. why so? What was the cause?
Well, from what I understand, he was always drunk. And he'd hang out outside the bars and try and trade his paintings for booze or money to buy booze with.
Isn't that something?
But he was quite an accomplished painter, and there's quite a few of his paintings around.
Yeah.
He would paint his main job was painting calendars.
Okay.
And then he would, he's famous for his skies.
Yeah. So he would probably just trade, like you say, for booze or whatever, food. But now those pieces are becoming sort of expensive, aren't they?
And
invaluable.
They're a piece of Reno history.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. And that's what I love about the store here is that you are preserving Reno history, Comstock history. I look forward to seeing other parts of the store. I just want to move over here, if we can, Dan, because I notice in the early days of Reno, there were some pretty nice homes, right? And people took a lot of pride in decorating their homes. And one of the kinds of pottery they used to put in the home was called Roseville. Now, tell us about the Roseville. Where was that made, and is it plentiful? Can you find it around here in quantity, or what?
Yeah, it's fairly popular. They had a really nice, pretty glaze, as you can see. It was made in Ohio. A lot of people would bring it across when they came across the country.
Oh, okay.
It's not. They started in the early days.
Uh-huh.
This example I have here is probably from the 30s or 40s.
I see. 30s or 40s. A beautiful piece. What would something like that be worth now?
It's not super expensive, but around $100 or so.
$100. Very pretty, though. Very nicely done. Here's a spittoon, by the way. I thought it was maybe a cookie jar, but it's a spittoon. And this is what we'd find in the early homes in Reno, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah. And this one's from the 1800s. This is in beautiful condition.
Right. It's a cobalt blue with a gold decoration.
All right.
And you can find them in everything from brass to fine porcelain, depending on the quality of the home. This is a pretty nice one.
Good. Let's keep this in mind, but I want to move on to other parts of the store because I'm really curious to see some of the casino memorabilia and some of the stuff from the Comstock.
Yeah.
We'll be back right after this.
Americans spend nearly 8 hours a day looking at screens. Which is great news for your business. Because helping you reach customers across every screen is what we do best. Get targeted, go farther. Charter Media is now Spectrum Reach.
Fun, fashionable, furs. Epitome of glamour for decades. Designer lines for women and men from around the world. 10,000 square foot showroom with hundreds of new fashions to choose from. Our biggest sale of the year is here. Enjoy savings of 50% off selected items. Treat yourself or your loved ones and choose from thousands of pieces in our beautiful new inventory. William Furs, a full service fur salon since 1977.
Somewhere in Time is the place to find the unexpected gift that will be treasured for all time, with one of the largest beer and sun purple glassware collections on the West Coast. Vintage toys, Roseville, Flow Blue, casino and brothel memorabilia, Fenton glassware, antique kerosene lamps, sports memorabilia, vintage neon and automobile ads. Yes, the unexpected. Find a gift that will be treasured for all time at Somewhere in Time in Reno.
Deluxe Travel, locally owned and operating since 1991, is the home for travel to Mexico and Central and South America. The crew at Deluxe Travel is bilingual, trustworthy, thorough, and caring. They will do everything possible to make your dream vacation the best it can be. Now is the time to book for winter travel, so stop by the office at 100 California Avenue or call 686-7000. You can also check us out on our website at deluxetravelltd.com.
At Deluxe Travel, we sell dreams. Come in and plan yours.
Your carpet and tile, make the right choice and call A-Choice. They use a two-step deep extraction steam cleaning system that removes dirt and those nasty mites and bacteria from your carpet and tile. A-Choice offers baby-safe cleaning products and specializes in pet odor removal. So make the fresher, cleaner, healthier choice. Call A-Choice Carpet and Tile Cleaning, locally owned and operated at 745-1863.
Hi there, I'm here Roy Marshall of the Marshall Mint in Virginia City, Nevada. I'm proud to announce that our 7-ingot set honoring the V&T Railroad is now finished.
That's right, Uroy. These beautiful 999 silver ingots celebrate the engines from the world-famous V&T Railroad and honor Nevada's sesquicentennial. These limited edition treasures can be purchased only at the Marshall Mint in Virginia City, Nevada.
Or visit us at marshallmint.com to get yours today.
We're back here in Old Tales of Nevada, past and present. We're at a store here in town called Somewhere in Time. It's on Virginia and Arroyo Street in the Statewide Lighting Center. You've probably been by this center many, many times, but stop in because this is a place that preserves history. And we're in another section of the store. I'm with Dan Clements, and he's one of the collectors, one of the antiquers you'll find here at the store that are very helpful, by the way, and very very knowledgeable. Dan's even an appraiser. So Dan, we're standing in front of this collection of, lack of a better word, kerosene lamps, right?
Right. They were an oil lamp.
Oil lamp, uh-huh. Did they always use kerosene, or was it some other kind of oil that they used there?
Kerosene is more of a modern invention.
Uh-huh. Oh,
before that, it was just a light oil, and before that was even whale oil.
Whale oil, okay. Now, how far back do some of these go? Are you looking at 1800s? And
most of these that I see here are all in the
1800s. Now, were these typical of what you would find in the Reno home back in the 1800s?
Oh,
or
absolutely.
Up on the Comstock?
Absolutely. And
that's basically how they lighted, right?
That was what they had.
Okay. Now, did they use any kind of these lamps down in the mines themselves, or was it mostly candlelight down in the mines?
Well, candlelight and then the acetylene lamps, which we'll look at in a little bit.
Okay.
These would have been too big for them to be carrying around and trying to work.
Right, right. That's for sure. I could see these things, though, in the mine office, you know.
Absolutely, yeah.
Or
up on top, they would have them.
Yeah, up in the Savage Mansion, for example, the place that Uroy owns. So beautiful pieces of work, though. I mean, are some of them more valuable than others because of the design of the glass or whatever?
Oh, absolutely. They started from the basic, simple little lamps, and if you were rich, you'd have a big, fancy, ornate lamp.
So really? Wow.
It was a lamp for every budget.
Now, how long would that lamp last? I mean, if you had it full of oil, how many hours would that give illumination?
That's a good question.
Yeah.
I'm not sure.
No.
Quite a while.
You don't know. Yeah, but you had to have quite a bit of oil. And
yeah,
to keep those things running, I would imagine. And did they put off fumes, too?
There are some.
Yeah.
You know, there's the problem with soot.
Well,
you
soot,
see,
right.
Most of the old houses, they had kind of black roofs. Well,
uh-huh.
That's why.
Right. Okay, good. I see some of them have color. Does that make them more expensive if they're in a pottery type of situation?
Yeah, absolutely. The more ornate the lamp, the more expensive it's going to be.
Yeah. Well, it really takes you back to the old days when you see these kinds of pieces, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And it's a real thing. It's not just a piece of junk that you'll find at a souvenir store or something.
That's right.
This is the real thing.
These have been around for over 100 years.
Yeah, people actually used them every day,
That's right.
To light their homes, to light their offices. And it's really cool to see them all in one place like that. Well, let's go over and take a look at some of the casino memorabilia and some of the artifacts from the Comstock as well.
Okay.
All right, let's go, folks. Now, this is something I'm really excited to have you talk about because I was doing some reading about the Comstock and some of the mines up there, like the Collar and the Savage and the Ophir. And when those guys were underground, they needed to have light.
It's dark under there.
It was very dark under there and very hot. It was very hot. You know, water was a big problem up there in the mines. They had to develop these major pumping systems to keep the water out. In fact, that was the demise of many of the mines. They just could not keep the water out.
They couldn't get the water out.
And Sutro tried to build a tunnel, but it was too late. You know, those kind of things. But when they were down there and they were able to work, they had to have light. And this is one source of light. Tell us about that.
Yeah, this is an acetylene light. And it's pretty basic. They would have the carbide inside, which is just a dry chemical. They would fill it up with water, and then this little thing on the top would adjust how fast the water went into the carbide. Well, water and carbide makes acetylene gas, and it would come out this little hole and light, and they would basically have a replacement for a candle.
No kidding,
and
really.
And it would last for much longer, obviously.
Much longer, yeah. Although the miners couldn't stay down there very long, as you probably know. It was so hot down there because of that hot water that you get down there, it'd be like 170, 130 degrees. So they'd only be in there for 20 minutes.
Yeah, you bet.
And then they have to go to what they call a cooling station where they had ice. And they had to sit in the ice so that they get rejuvenated and then go back in and work again. And this, so anyway, this is very precious. And how did you get a hold of something like that?
This one probably came from an auction.
Oh, it did.
But occasionally,
huh?
People bring them in. But usually, we find these in estates and auctions.
No kidding.
And this one would have been mounted on a hat. It's got the little clip.
Okay.
So it would have mounted on the.
Was it a hard hat type of deal,
right,
that they had there? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Wow. Now, how often do you come across those in northern Nevada? Are they something that you'll find?
They're fairly prevalent because there was a lot of mining here.
Right.
So we come across them.
Yeah. Okay. Very good. Well, that's exciting to see that, and you know, just think, you let your imagination go with you there and think about who had this on their hat.
What it seen.
And what they saw. And the work that went on down in those mines. You were saying you don't have one with you now, but you had the actual...
The rock drill. Basically a big chisel and a sledgehammer, and they'd be beating away on this thing down in the mine.
Yeah, so they'd make the hole so they could put the explosive in there so they could knock the ore out, right? But boy, oh boy, I'd like to see, if that could only talk.
Yeah,
that would really be something. We have something right behind us here too. That's pretty cool. This is an original wagon wheel, right?
These are buckboard wheels.
Buckboard wheels. Yeah, amazing stuff. So this would go on, and this is what people would use for transport to and from the market or whatever.
That was their tires of the day.
Yeah, yeah. So what ranch did they come from, do you
These
know?
These came from from one of the ranches that was out on Glendale. I don't know the name of it.
Oh, okay.
The guy that brought them in, that's where
they
came
from. Okay, I'm trying to think.
From.
There's a couple of big ranches, more big ranches out there before. In fact, the big ranch house is still out there. We did a show on it. I think it's the Flick Ranch. It was out there right next to the river, and they're trying to save that farmhouse. Maybe it came from there, huh?
Maybe.
Ah.
Don't know.
That was a big cattle ranch out there. Okay. And also a dairy ranch, by the way.
Oh,
did you know that?
I didn't know that.
Yeah. Uh-huh. So all of that right there, and this is the act. How old do you think that is?
Turn of the century.
Turn of the century, huh? Wow, pretty amazing stuff. Now here, over here, I just want to walk over here again, going back to some of the.
This is what's got me started.
This is what got you started, huh?
Yeah,
Is this green glass?
I walked into a store and they had a small display of it.
Uh huh. And what do you call this now?
This is Vaseline glass, and some of it is Green Depression.
Okay.
Which was from the 30s, but Vaseline glass goes back to the 1800s. A lot of these pieces are from the 1800s.
Now, was it toxic or anything like that?
A little bit to make it,
but
once it's made, the uranium oxide, which is the mineral that makes the yellow glow, is locked in the glass, and it's very slightly radioactive, but not enough.
Okay, so you could put
anything.
It in your home today if you wanted to. And,
yeah, it's perfectly
and
safe.
And you'd be okay with
You wouldn't
that.
Want to store your liquor in it.
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you, your interests are very diverse. I see all kinds of things here. I see, you know, some old, I don't know what that is, old toys. No, that's another decanter.
That's a Jim Beam decanter.
Decanter,
right?
Yeah.
We've got the radio tubes from back in the days when the
radios
had tubes.
Oh, boy. Yeah, I remember seeing those, that's for sure. Yeah. And the old Kodak film and things.
Box cameras.
So your interests go all over the place, don't they?
I'm all over.
Yeah, yeah. Well, let's continue walking through here. I saw an item as I was coming through that was pretty cool. You know, back on the Comstock days, the mines were closely tied to the stock market back in those days, you know. And it was mostly in the San Francisco market, not so much the New York market, I don't think. But anyway, when I went by this, it reminded me of the old days on the stock market. What is this?
This is an actual, pretty rare piece. This is a stand from the Wall Street Journal that the little ticker tape machine would have sat on top of.
Oh, no kidding.
So if
really?
We had a ticker tape machine, it would have sat right here in this.
Yeah.
It's got the little scissors with it to cut the tape off.
Cut the tape, right? It says Dow Jones, the Wall Street Journal, right there. How about that? I mean, that's a recent acquisition for you, isn't it?
It is.
Yeah, yeah. So let's walk this way. I know there's something around the corner here I wanted to see. And as we're coming through, Caesar, our cameraman, can show you, you know, what's available. There's all kinds of things. But I know back in this part of the store, there's some vintage toys, right?
Well, that's actually a little bit over.
Is it over that way?
Yeah, it's a big store. It's all
okay.
over the place.
Well, let's keep walking. We got all kinds of books here.
Right.
That people
and
can
another thing
look
that's kind of interesting to talk about is occupied Japan.
Oh, okay.
Back right after World War II,
right.
The U.S. occupied Japan.
Right.
And Japan was famous for making these little figurines and lots of different porcelain things.
Okay.
Well, they made them, because of the occupation, marked them as occupied Japan,
oh.
not just made in Japan,
oh.
which they severely resented.
All right. And you find these in northern Nevada as well?
Right.
So the guys from World War II would bring them home.
Right.
Yeah. How about that?
So this whole shelf is occupied Japan pieces.
All right. Now, is this part of your collection or this is another vendor?
This is me.
Oh, this is you too?
Yeah.
Wow. It takes a lot. You have to have rather a broad knowledge of what you're dealing with. Do you find yourself reading a lot or doing a lot of research?
A lot of research.
Because
you know, a lot of that comes too from being at the auction and watching what sells and getting an idea of trends because things go in and out of favor all the time.
Now, do you find that antiquers and guys who collect, are they guys and gals, I should say, do they do a lot of communication back and forth?
To an extent.
Yeah.
You know, there's always this little tight-knit thing of, I know this, maybe I don't want to tell you this.
Right, because I might find something that's really cool and I don't want you to have it, I want it, right?
But a lot of us really do want the knowledge to get out there, so we help educate as much as we can.
Yeah, okay. Well, let's keep moving back this way, and I'm just going to, we'll keep looking. This is another area of the store that I think is really, really neat, especially for car buffs. And if you had a car back in the 40s and the 50s, this can bring back a lot of old memories right here because this is a place where somebody has collected all the old ads.
Yeah, Reno Dave has a huge collection of vintage car ads.
Yeah.
Pretty much any car that you've got, if you want to get an old original ad, you can find it here, or he's got a little sign-up list because he's got thousands of these in storage that he
can't
put out.
Wouldn't that be cool, though, if you had a car like that when you were a teenager? And now you could come in and get the actual ad and frame it and make it look pretty cool.
Or even now, a lot of the Holocaust nights, this is a really popular place during Holocaust nights.
I would imagine so.
Guys come looking for
ads. I think we have to take a break here on Old Tales of Nevada Past and Present, so let's do that, and then we'll come back, and I want to get over towards these vintage toys that you have that I know kids in Reno were playing with back in the day.
You bet.
All right, we'll be right back.
Yikes! Look what's in your carpet and tile. Dirty, nasty dust mites, bacteria, germs, and pet odor. Make the right choice and call A-Choice Carpet and Tile Cleaning today. They use a two-step system that removes all that nasty stuff from your carpet and tile, and they offer baby-safe cleaning products. Call A-Choice today. The first 25 customers to call will get 3 rooms cleaned for the price of 2. Call today, 745-1863.
Deluxe Travel, locally owned and operating since 1991, is the home for travel to Mexico and Central and South America. The crew at Deluxe Travel is bilingual, trustworthy, thorough, and caring. They will do everything possible to make your dream vacation the best it can be. Now is the time to book for winter travel. So stop by the office at 100 California Avenue or call 686-7000. You can also check us out on our website at deluxetravelltd.com.
At Deluxe Travel, we sell dreams. Come in and plan yours.
Somewhere in Time is the place to find the unexpected gift that will be treasured for all time, with one of the largest beer and sun purple glassware collections on the West Coast. Vintage Toys, Roseville, Flow Blue, Casino and Brothel Memorabilia, Fenton Glassware, Antique Kerosene Lamps, Sports Memorabilia, Vintage Neon, and Automobile Ads. Yes, the unexpected. Find a gift that will be treasured for all time at Somewhere in Time in Reno.
The beautiful fall colors are being duplicated in the fall collection of fashions at Boutique Elegante. Sweaters are either in the crayon colors for fall or soft muted shades in bark and beige. For our cold winter days, jackets and vests are the perfect answer. Faux fur and faux leather are the strong fabrics for this season. Team Fam with maxi skirts for a beautiful seasonal look. All of this and so much more at Boutique Elegante.
We're back here in Old Tales of Nevada, past and present, and I'm John O'Brien, the host of the show, and with me today is Dan Clements, who is here at Somewhere in Time, and it's a store you'll find on Arroyo and Virginia Street in a statewide lighting center right in the middle of the parking lot there, and it's easy parking,
easy parking here.
And if you want to spend some time just kind of getting involved in history, this is a place to come. As we've been showing already in our program, there's a lot of artifacts here from the old days, both in the residential homes and in the mining activity. And now we're standing right in front of some of the vintage toys that were used by kids back in the old days here in Reno, right?
Yeah, Phil has a nice selection, and it's always changing.
Yeah.
He likes toys, so he's our go-to toy person.
Yeah, some of these toys, I look at them, and those are some of the things that we used to play with when we were kids, like Lionel rolling stock, you know, the little... everything was made of metal in those days.
Right.
It wasn't plastic, was it? Yeah.
Right, and it's a little Japan tin toys. Those are really popular. Right after the war.
Yeah, yeah. And you got the airplanes we used to play with.
Tonka trucks.
Tonka trucks, always, yeah. And he's got a whole area here. So, boy, your imagination, you know, your memory just goes back in time when you come into a place like this and see these toys. I used to play with that, you know.
Yeah, we hear that a lot.
Yeah, yeah.
I had one of those.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, I think even up in the old days of the Comstock, there were kids up there, right?
Absolutely.
There were families, and they had their primitive toys, and they were probably much the same as this, correct?
Right. They what they had, and, of course, marbles. And
yeah.
We do have marbles in the store, too.
No kidding, marbles, huh?
Yeah.
Now, that's a funny-looking piece right there. Is that a safe or something? Piggy bank?
That's an early bank.
That's an early bank.
Yeah. So it would have been cast iron.
Oh, okay. And they put their little coins in there,
right.
Silver dollars.
And maybe their parents would know the combination and the kid wouldn't, you know?
Yeah, there you go. That's a good way to go, actually, you know. I wanted to walk over here. Well, here's some more over here. This might be something that a child would play with up on the Comstock, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Some more toys.
Yeah. I mean, it's really, this has got to be, this has got to have some age on. How old do you think that is right there?
It probably goes... Not to the 1800s, but the mid-century.
You're really, huh? All right. And these are these HO, what are they called, HO trains?
I think that's actually N-gauge.
Those N-gauge,
a little smaller.
Uh-huh. Wow. And here's an old, well, this isn't too old, I don't think. It looks like an action figure.
He's been around a while. That's probably a G.I. Joe.
Now, what's this right here? Is that another one of those?
That's a lamp that you would have taken out camping.
Perhaps. Oh, I see. Okay. Well, now, here's something that looks quite old, if I can pick it up. Right here.
Look it's obviously that. Seen a lot of play.
Fisher Price.
Right, so that would have been, again, mid-century, probably mid-century. The 50s. A little pull toy for kids.
Yeah, I imagine people watching the show would relate to some of these toys, huh?
Back when they made them out of wood.
Yeah. So come on down, and you can take a look at all this stuff, and you can just browse to your heart's content here, right?
Absolutely.
And if you do find some, I understand that antiques in Reno are not as expensive as they might be in other parts of the country. Why is that?
I think it's just the economy.
Yeah.
We're not that big of a place.
Right.
So they're just, the costs aren't there.
Right. So if you want to come in...
Things are affordable.
Yeah, you want to come in and take home a piece of nostalgia, mm-hmm. then you can get it for a halfway decent price here at Somewhere in Time, which
is very
cool.
Plus, we do layaways, too. So if it's something that they want and it's maybe a little more than they can afford, they can make payments.
Make payments on it. Okay, very good. Well, let's go back this way, and we'll see some more of the artifacts. I see we have some belt buckles from different casinos here, like Caesars and was that Paul Frank Industries, a lot of different stores and concerns here in town, entities here in town.
Yeah.
All right. So you can find that kind of thing.
In the next case over, we've got more of the casino tokens.
Oh, look at this here, Caesar.
The silver strikes that were made out of solid silver.
Oh, okay.
And you'd play a special machine, and if you got a jackpot, you'd win one of these silver strikes.
Okay. Do you have a lot of that kind of thing, a lot of the casino type of memorabilia here in town?
Obviously.
Yeah. I mean, that should be fairly... plentiful, I would think, right?
It is.
Now,
there are some things that are more rare.
Uh-huh.
You know, The little silver strikes are out there, but you've got to look for them.
Yeah, yeah.
And there are serious collectors that haunt the stores just looking for things like that.
Sure, yeah. This is what Uroy Marshall looks for when he's out hunting for memorabilia and artifacts, as the old coins, the silver type of thing. So that's really great to see. Now, when you come in here, how do they price things like this? Is it one price, the same price all the time, or are you constantly changing prices on silver like
that?
Well,
they vary.
Yeah.
In most cases, the things like the silver strikes have a general price that they're going for.
Okay, so you know where you're at.
Yeah, you do some research, and maybe there's a rare one that costs more.
Yeah. What's all these bells over here that I'm looking at? These a special collection of some sort, what?
It were probably somebody's collection.
Yeah, look at that.
And in the old days, that was a common, old days to me.
Uh-huh, yeah.
That was a common souvenir when you went somewhere, was you'd buy a thimble or a bell to take home and put it on your shelf. So there's ones from all over the place.
Yeah, it looks
here.
Like they're all over the United States here, you know. Mm-hmm. But do they actually put down the year that they're from, or?
Occasionally they'll have a year.
Do that, huh?
Mostly it's just a place.
Yeah, okay, very good. So,
there are some event ones, you know, like for a World's Fair or something, that will obviously have the date.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. There's another little toy. Look at this. Remember these when you were a little kid?
Radio flyer.
Radio flyer. That's one of the originals right there, huh?
Yeah.
I used to have a radio flyer. But it was a wagon. I had a wagon.
Yeah, I think we all had wagons.
Yeah, the wagon. You got Native American?
Right. There's a lot of Native American here.
Is it mostly Paiute?
No, it's all over.
Yeah?
A lot of Paiute and Washoe, obviously, because that's what's here.
Right, right.
But there, occasionally we buy collections from people from other parts of the country as well.
Sure,
but
sure.
But mostly it's Western.
Yeah. There's John Lennon up there. You even have some pictures of him from the Beatles. All right. Elvis Presley pictures.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yep, got to have an Elvis.
Here's a bust of Elvis Presley right here.
Yeah.
So, just about anything you could possibly think about looking at, you can find right here at the store. Yeah. How many vendors do you have?
We have about 18 right now.
Yeah, and they're all kind of different in your interest.
Right. That's what's nice about a mall, is each little section is an individual person.
Yeah.
He has the things that he likes.
Right.
And maybe somebody else will like something else. So it gives you a big diversity in one store.
That's for sure. That's for sure. Old grandfather clock there and more artwork and... Let's walk around the store. I want to go back. Oh, can we get to that part of the store? We have to go that way.
Well, let's get the rocking horse here.
That's cool. Oh yeah. Tell us about this rocking horse. Any history on this?
Right. He's painted, as he says right here, by GL, whoever that was, in April of 1989. So it's basically not an antique rocking horse, but it's done in the antique style.
Right, yeah.
And it's just a
nicely... Is this
a
pretty popular item, these rocking horses? I remember I used to buy my kids a rocking horse when they were small. The last
probably not
years.
Quite as fancy as that
not
one.
Not as fancy as that, by sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, and what's back in here?
This is Greg and Norman's booth, and it's... lots.
Yeah, it's just a potpourri of everything.
Yeah.
In there. A lot of brass. Looks like brass.
Brass. He's got Indian. There's military back there.
Yeah.
Lots of jewelry.
What are those lamps over there? Railroad lamps?
Right. He's a retired railroad engineer.
Yeah. Do you have V&T memorabilia in the store?
There's occasionally one or two pieces,
yeah,
but it's pretty rare.
Yeah, V&T is getting hard to find.
Most of it's in private collections.
And everybody knows what V&T Railroad is. If it wasn't for the V&T Railroad, a lot of things that were going on in the Comstock wouldn't have happened.
That's right. The Virginia and Truckee Railroad.
Right, right. Because they couldn't... The horses and the mules and so on just couldn't carry the loads.
It was just too much.
Yeah, so that's why I think it was Sharon, I think, is the guy that brought in the railroad.
That sounds familiar.
Yeah, So we find that down here, too.
Yeah, so we always have some railroad stuff in here.
Yeah. I mean, like I say, just about anybody's interest, you can be satisfied here. You even have a little bit of furniture from the old days there?
Right. The Ramos Drugs opened in 1951. That's the actual stools out of that old drugstore.
Okay. Where was that located?
That's a good question. I'm not sure. I know it's in Reno, but that's all I know.
No kidding. Yeah, it didn't put down the address, did it?
Okay.
Huh?
Yeah, it says now the Ramos building is now the cheese board.
Oh, the cheese board. So it's in Midtown.
Midtown.
Yeah, Midtown. Okay, very good. But in the old days, that was a big store, huh? That was a big drugstore. How about this? Look at this typewriter here.
Yeah. Man.
I remember using this.
That's modern.
That's modern, huh? Man,
That's a nice decorative.
That's just a decorative piece.
It could probably be used.
Yeah.
But
It's not an antique necessarily, though. Is it a reproduction?
No, it's not a reproduction.
No, it's a real thing.
It's the real thing.
Man, oh, man.
So it's the early part of the century.
Yeah. And then over here, you got some old saddles and photographs and appliances and from the old days, you know, at least the 50s, right? Huh?
Mm-hmm.
And then what's this back here? Oh, you got the old, some old mixers and...
Yeah, Larry has a really nice eclectic mix of unusual things.
Yeah. Well, I could see people, still decorating their homes with some of these things, you know?
That's what they're for.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Here's an old... what do they call it?
Looks like a slot machine.
Slot machine. I don't know if it's a real one or not. But
well, it's a little bank. And those are, again, a popular tourist collectible.
Yeah. Pretty amazing. Pretty amazing. And then what do we have as we... Oh, look at this old bike right here. This thing. How old do you think that is?
I think this is actually a reproduction of a 1935 Streamline.
Oh, okay.
So... back in 1935, that's what you would be buying.
That was a little before my time. I didn't have one of those. I had a Schwinn. Yeah. Remember the old Schwinns with the horn and all that kind of thing on them?
Yeah, a little bell.
Yeah, a little bell. All right. Well, we're gonna break from here, and then we're gonna walk around the corner and take a look at some of the beer memorabilia
and the
over
casino
there.
Stuff.
And the casino stuff. All right. So be back on Old Tales of Nevada right after this.
Hi there, I'm here Roy Marshall of the Marshall Mint in Virginia City, Nevada. I'm proud to announce that our 7-ingot set honoring the V&T Railroad is now finished.
That's right, you, Roy. These beautiful 999 silver ingots celebrate the engines from the world-famous V&T Railroad and honor Nevada's sesquicentennial. These limited edition treasures can be purchased only at the Marshall Mint in Virginia City, Nevada.
Or visit us at marshallmint.com to get yours today.
Fun, fashionable, furs. Epitome of glamour for decades. Designer lines for women and men from around the world. 10,000 square foot showroom with hundreds of new fashions to choose from. Our biggest sale of the year is here. Enjoy savings of 50% off selected items. Treat yourself or your loved ones and choose from thousands of pieces in our beautiful new inventory. William Furs, a full service fur salon since 1977.
The beautiful fall colors are being duplicated in the fall collection of fashions at Boutique Elegante. Sweaters are either in the crayon colors for fall or soft muted shades in bark and beige. For our cold winter days, jackets and vests are the perfect answer. Full fur and full leather are the strong fabrics for this season. Team them with maxi skirts for a beautiful seasonal look. All of this and so much more at Boutique Elegante.
Yikes! Look what's in your carpet and tile. Dirty, nasty dust mites, bacteria, germs, and pet odor. Make the right choice and call A-Choice Carpet and Tile Cleaning today. They use a two-step system that removes all that nasty stuff from your carpet and tile, and they offer baby-safe cleaning products. Call A-Choice today. The first 25 customers to call will get 3 rooms cleaned for the price of 2. Call today, 745-1863.
Deluxe Travel, locally owned and operating since 1991, is the home for travel to Mexico and Central and South America. The crew at Deluxe Travel is bilingual, trustworthy, thorough, and caring. They will do everything possible to make your dream vacation the best it can be. Now is the time to book for winter travel, so stop by the office at 100 California Avenue or call 686-7000. You can also check us out on our website at deluxetravelltd.com.
At Deluxe Travel, we sell dreams. Come in and plan yours.
If you're a fan of Old Tales of Nevada, past and present, we are proud to announce that now you can purchase any of our past episodes on our new website, talesofnevada.com.
That's right. These stories of our great Nevada history are now available to you on DVD. Over 180 individual episodes featuring the people, places, and stories that have made us all so proud to live in this great state. So get yours today, A Piece of Nevada History. Visit talesofnevada.com.
We're back here in our last segment of Old Tales of Nevada, Past and Present. And again, I'm John O'Brien, the host. And with me is Dan Clements, one of the collectors and one of the antiquers here in the store. And as you've seen, I mean, this place is an amazing... I mean, it's not a museum, but it is...
A lot of history here.
A lot of history here.
History you can take home.
Yeah, that's right. You can take it home and put it right on a shelf or in a safe or wherever you want to do with it. Here's another big section of the store, and it's the casino and beer memorabilia and collectibles. And I'll tell you, it's got just about everything you could possibly think of in Northern Nevada that happened in that category is displayed here in some way or another. I noticed right off the bat that thing from the Reno Air Races from 1970. Tell us about that piece.
Yeah, that's another Jim Beam decanter. They would do the special event decanters, trying to sell their liquor, of course.
Right.
But
right.
They've turned into quite a collectible thing. They've done a lot of Nevada decanters.
Yeah. Well, is it the distributor who is making these for the events, or the events are licensing them from the distributor?
Well, the events aren't making the decanters, but they're licensing their name to be used on the decanters.
Oh, okay. So Southern Wine and Spirits, for example, could commission
to have
right. Okay,
one
very
made
good
for them.
Yeah, and here's the old Ponderosa Ranch. No longer in business,
unfortunately.
Did you ever get up there yourself?
No.
No, I did, though. I did.
I didn't.
In fact, I think I have one of those cups at home.
A popular collectible.
Yeah, yeah. And Jackpot Junction, were you familiar where that was? An old casino, evidently.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? And what else that I pick up on here?
Well, there's Herald's Club things.
Where do you see that? Show me the Herald's Club.
We've got Herald's Club glasses.
Oh, okay. Very good.
For example.
Uh-huh. And, of course, Herald's Club was one of the big marketers in Reno. They were all over the United States.
Herald's Club or bust.
Yeah, exactly. Remember seeing the signs out on a highway? You're so many miles away from Herald's Club.
Yeah. And they had the big sign that's down at the Livestock Event Center now on the front of their building.
Okay.
The Pioneer sign.
That's right. Exactly.
That came off the Herald's Club building.
Yeah. And so let's just move down here. Here we have all kinds of, what's this, Jackpot Junction. That must have been... The place at one time.
So, these are reproduction brothel tokens, actually, which are turning into quite a nice collectible.
Okay. So a token. Well, now, what would you do with the token?
Well, the idea was that you have this token, you could take it in and have your fun for the evening.
Oh, I see.
Whether they actually existed, that I don't know. But they're a popular collectible now.
I see. Okay, very good. And then back here we have, you know what's really cool back here is you have all these neon signs. You don't see much of that.
He has a large collection.
Yeah, so like Hams and Fat Tire, Pabst Blue Ribbon, Olympia. That's all kinds of things I used to drink when I was in the Air Force, you know, up in Great Falls, Montana. So, I'll tell you, if you want something of that need, you can find it right here.
Right.
These are all
the beer handles, the tap handles. So,
do you find a lot of that at the auctions nowadays, or is that something that's
becoming more rare? Those are pretty hard to come by.
Yeah, and they're popular. Mm-hmm. Beer memorabilia is popular right now.
Yeah, and they have such fun handles.
Yeah,
they sure do. They make a nice collectible.
That's for sure. All right, let's move around here. And you've got horse collars back here. You got gas cans. I understand gas cans are becoming popular, and oil cans are popular.
Yeah, anything petroleum related. For the people that put in their garages, you know, the man caves.
Yeah. Like this kind of a 5-gallon can is something that I don't know if this particular one is very valuable, but I saw some of these shows on TV where they actually seek these out, you know, for whatever reason. They pay quite a bit of money for it, so.
Yes, they do.
You have some of that right here in the store.
And, of course, the ashtrays. Mike has a large collection of ashtrays.
From the casinos.
Yeah.
No kidding.
One of the most popular theft items, of course, for advertising.
Everybody takes the ashtray home, right?
Yep.
Yeah, that's for sure. Now, what's this over here? This is a whole different area, or?
This is all part of Mike's as well.
Oh, yeah.
He likes the old cars, so he does have a nice selection of the vintage look cars.
Now, if you wanted to talk to Mike or any of the vendors, how do you know when they're here?
Well, that's a good question. We all have different days. I'm here every Monday.
Oh, I see. Okay.
But, you know, most of the vendors have other jobs.
I see.
So they work here when they can. But we have their business cards for almost all of them at the counter.
Okay.
So if you want to talk to one of them, we've got their numbers, and they can call them and talk to the guy and make an appointment to meet down here.
Meet down there. And pretty much any day of the week, you're open, right?
What? The store's open.
Seven days a week?
7 days
a week. Yeah, 7 days a week. And the owner, Bill's usually here on Saturday.
On Saturdays.
Right? Yeah. So if you want to talk to him, you can do that. There's the Hams beer over there.
Yeah, there's a pretty rare piece.
Yeah, Hams the Bear. Remember the TV commercials of that? And, well, just about anything back here regarding beer you can find right here in the store. So what do we have around the corner here now?
Okay, now we get into Janice's booth.
Yeah.
And she likes a lot of the old-time porcelain and pottery and things that they would have used in the old days.
I see.
And she has a big selection of that, as well as some of the toys. She has a little miniature section, and a lot of these miniatures are from the 50s and 40s.
Right here from the local area in many cases.
To fill up your little dollhouse.
Well, one thing she had is that Flo Blue.
And she has a nice selection of Flo Blue.
What is Flo Blue?
Flo Blue is blue and white pottery.
Uh-huh.
And it started out in the early days, China was fabulous at making high-end porcelain. They've been doing it for thousands of years.
Right.
Well, the English tried to copy them by doing the blue on white porcelain like the Chinese.
Okay.
But they didn't know how to do it right.
Oh.
And when they fired it, the blue would just, instead of staying, it would just kind of spread out and flow.
Okay.
And it turned out that people liked that look, so they kept doing it.
So many good things happen by accident.
Just by accident.
Yeah.
Right.
You just happen to stumble across it. So that's great. I noticed in the window you have a neon sign for Tahoe Beer. Mm-hmm. And Tahoe Beer was one of the big beers.
Yeah, they're highly collectible. They weren't in business very long, and I don't know many of the details.
Yeah.
But we do have that nice neon.
Yeah, beautiful.
And they've recently reopened.
Oh, they did.
So there is
in Tahoe.
There is a new Tahoe beer.
That's pretty amazing that the craft beer business in Northern Nevada is really starting to proliferate.
It really has taken off.
It was dead for a while, but everybody's doing it now, it seems. Yeah.
So the Flo Blue is right down this corner here.
Yeah, let's take a look at that Flo Blue. I saw it the other day when we were here, and it really caught my eye.
And she has a nice selection.
Yeah. Is it fairly rare?
It's fairly rare.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And they also had Flo Black. There's a black one at the top.
Oh, Flo Black.
As well.
No kidding.
And they would sometimes mix it with colors.
Yeah. So it became a real industry. Where did that take place? Whereabouts in the
United? England.
Oh, in England.
Most of it came from England.
All right. Very good. What years did they do that?
The most popular is turn of the century.
Okay.
Late 1800s.
Okay. So it's becoming rather valuable now over the years, huh? Okay. There's one other section I wanted to take a look at, and that's your sports memorabilia. Bill, the owner, told me that's a pretty nice collection you have there as well. All of this over here. Is there any local connection here as far as what we see in the booth here?
That, like, I couldn't tell you. I'm not a sports person.
You're not a sports person,
huh? I don't know.
Yeah. Well, I see there's some San Francisco stuff, the Yankees, the Marlins baseball teams, all the National League teams are all mentioned there. So.
And he has a big selection of baseball cards.
Yeah.
And football cards as well.
Did you ever play with baseball cards when you were a kid? Collect them?
No, we never.
Yeah, we used to flip them, flip the cards, and if it landed heads, you won the guy. You had to call heads or tails, and so you collect cards that way. So
we did that with marbles.
You did it with marbles, yeah. Here's some of the cards over there. Caesar, if you can get a shot of that, that would be. Let's see, Babe Ruth right there. Are some of these pretty valuable? That
He has some quite valuable ones.
No kidding.
And then he's got whole sets where you can buy like a whole Pacers set or a Florida Marlins set of cards.
Okay. What's the most valuable? What's the holy grail of cards? Isn't it Honus Wagner?
Honus Wagner.
Yeah. Honus Wagner. If you can find one of those, you've got yourself.
One of the old original ones, yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah, big money.
I don't think you'd find too many of those laying around anymore, though, huh?
No, pretty much. Anybody that knows they have one is knows it.
Yeah. So what's the store? Is there room for expansion? How do you find the antique and collectible business in Reno now? Is it expanding, contracting? It seems like there's more and more to me. I don't know.
I think it's expanding again. There used to be a big antiques community.
Uh-huh.
And then a number of years ago, city of Reno had for a short time passed a law that made it just prohibitively expensive to be an antique dealer. They were treating them like a pawn shop where they had
to
report everything they bought, and it was just ridiculous. So a lot of the old-time vendors just threw up their hands and gave up.
Retired,
So a lot of the antique malls that were in town have closed.
Did they change the law eventually?
Right.
Oh, they did,
So they've reversed themselves, and part of that was the state of Nevada passed a law saying that they couldn't do that.
Yeah.
So that really helped us. We all went, oh, wow.
Yeah. Do you find quite a few Californians, for example, coming over to Reno to shop for antiques because of pricing and one thing
because
or another?
Because of pricing, yeah.
And the uniqueness of the Comstock and...
Yeah,
and the gaming and so on that you find here?
Yeah, we were talking to a gentleman yesterday when I was working here, as a matter of fact, that is from California. He comes over here to buy mining stuff.
I see.
Because he can buy it here inexpensive enough that he can take it back and make a profit on it.
Yeah, there you go.
In his store in California.
Yeah, because you don't try to make a killing on every piece that you sell, right?
And that goes back to the pricing. We try to be reasonable.
Yeah, yeah.
If we get something for a good price, then we try and make it.
You make a little bit here, a little bit there. And before you know, you got a pile of money, right? At least you hope so. Okay. Well, listen, we want to thank you for giving us a tour of the store. And I really wanted to come in here because to me, it's like going back in time, going back in history. It brings back a lot of memories, all these different areas of the store and the different items you have. So I'd like to invite, everybody down and take a look. You don't have to buy anything. Just come out and browse.
And I also
want to
put a little plug in for our Tanner's Marketplace shows.
Yeah, absolutely.
We have about five of those a year.
Exactly.
Our next one is February 6th and 7th.
Look forward to that. We'll be doing some advertising on that to remind people when it's going to happen over at the Livestock Event Center.
And that's
there.
A great place to go look for antiques.
Absolutely.
Too.
And we want to invite people to, before I forget and leave the show, we got a seminar coming up over there in the Silverland Inn and Suites up in Virginia City. We're going to have Scott Jolkover. We're actually going to shoot the show live there at the Silverland Inn and Suites, and we're going to be talking about the history of the Kohler and the Savage Mines. So a very interesting story. I've been doing a lot of research on it, so we'll be doing that. In the meantime, we want to invite you back next week for another episode of Old Tales of Nevada, Past and Present. If you're a fan of Old Tales of Nevada, Past and Present, we are proud to announce that now you can purchase any of our past episodes on our new website, talesofnevada.com. That's right, these stories of our great Nevada history are now available to you on DVD. Over 180 individual episodes featuring the people, places, and stories that have made us all so proud to live in this great state. So get yours today, A Piece of Nevada History. Visit talesofnevada.com.